Let's get more from Dr. John Hemmings, who's director of the Asia Studies Center at the Henry Jackson Society. We have spoken about North Korea and this war of words several times. It goes beyond that when we hear talk about a potential hydrogen bomb test.
Absolutely. This is kind of a nightmare scenario for both the United States and its allies. As we saw in New York on Thursday, Foreign Secretary Ri Hong-yeo asserted that this could happen, but when asked and pushed a little bit, he seemed to fall back that it was up to the dear leader, Kim Jong-un. So whether it happens or not, or it's an empty threat, we'll see. But in the past, when these threats have happened and they've been pushed, the Koreans have gone ahead and followed through.
And if, for example, you're sitting in Japan or in Guam, that's a really worrying threat.
Well, exactly. The most likely scenario people are thinking is that it would be a missile-based test. So they'd essentially fire it into an area that they had pre-warned and asked ships to avoid, rather than using a kind of deployed vessel which could be intercepted. So you have to wonder if that missile goes off course, if it strays, if there are any technical difficulties. There's any number of problems that could go wrong with it. And we're looking at a blast that would be some 16 times bigger than Hiroshima.
So you expect there will be some mechanism by which Pyongyang says, clear this section of the ocean?
Yes, I think they are still clinging to some small shreds of legitimacy. So they will try to avoid firing into shipping lanes. They will probably avoid firing towards any land masses or areas. It will be an empty space in the Pacific, which is, after all, fairly large. But the real question is whether or not they fire that missile over Japan. So we've had already two recent missiles that were fired over Japan, and one in the past in the 90s. And what Tokyo's reaction to that will be, we can only guess.
And just thinking of the level of threats, I mean, you seem to have a kind of dialogue over the internet between Donald Trump and Kim Jong-un now, each outdoing the other. Does it play into the North Korean leader's hands to be seen to be having this kind of conversation?
Absolutely. I think he is probably enjoying this attention that he's having. You know, North Korea's got, I think, something under 20 million people. Here he is dialoguing with one of the, you know, the world's largest countries, getting all the attention he could ever want. Remember, this is a young man. You know, he's only taken power quite recently. So it must be feeding into his ego, I have no doubt.
Interesting when you read through the statement that was issued from Kim Jong-un. I mean, he does talk about kind of raining fire down on the U.S., etc. But for a lot of it, he's trying to position himself as the more prudent of the leaders, saying, you know, to Donald Trump, you're using the wrong language. This is too rash. It's very strange reading, bizarre.
It is. It's probably, I mean, having written about North Korea for 10 years, I do find that in some ways the strategy that Donald Trump has adapted is not a bad one, to push on China regarding sanctions just to get North Korea back to the table and renegotiate. But his communication style has been unprecedented in U.S. presidential history. And it feeds right into the kind of claims that actually the U.S. is the one being unreasonable, which in this case, you know, is not the case.
John, always good to speak to you. I'm sure we'll speak again. Thank you. Do stay with us here on BBC World News. Still to come.